Welcome back to another segment of ACRP TV. Today, our spotlight is on an interesting topic, navigating state law qualifications for clinical researchers. And it's more complicated than it might sound. We've got a good guest with us today to talk to us about it. Dr. Muriel Ramaswamy is the president and CEO of Pulmonics. Thank you so much for joining us today, doctor.
Thank you, Michael. Thanks for having me. Glad to be here.
Good. Now, we've talked about this a little bit in the past, and I must admit, this is a little over my head, but I can see the importance of it. I don't understand the ramifications and the granularity the way you do, but if you could lay out for us what this issue is about overlapping or not overlapping state regulations and the qualifications, what's the problem here? What's the challenge?
Okay, great. Great question, and thanks for asking that. Principally, a clinical research coordinator works under the delegation of a principal investigator who typically is a physician. And so if you look at the tasks given to a clinical research coordinator, you can split it into two tasks, a non-clinical, which would be things like data entry and research, okay? And then there are clinical tasks, which would be anything from greeting a patient, taking a consent, doing an EKG, doing vital signs, doing blood draws or phlebotomies. These are clinical tasks, including medication administration. And so it's in the area of clinical tasks where the state regulations and policy regulations that are unrelated to research or that were designed without taking research into account that come into play. And we find those regulations sometimes to pose a constraint in terms of being able to hire clinical coordinators and have them perform clinical skills.
So it creates a bit of a bottleneck, I would think.
Absolutely.
Now, I appreciate you raising this issue for us, and that's why one of the reasons we're here. We like to raise topics that maybe people aren't completely aware of. I get the sense, correct me if I'm wrong, that maybe a lot of people in the clinical trial industry don't realize this. They maybe get tripped up by this sometimes.
Correct. So, like, I think at freestanding sites, it's from what I've heard, is not a problem because, you know, in general, clinical trials comes under FDA oversight, so it's pre-approval, world. Freestanding sites, as long as the PI has delegated and trained a particular individual, regardless of their background, the FDA is generally okay with that. But when it comes to doing the same task in a health system, hospital policies can vary. And sometimes community health systems might not know that clinical trials comes under a pre-approval world. And it comes under PI oversight and FDA regulation and IRB oversight. But these policies then can potentially impact a throughput in being able to conduct clinical trials.
So for someone watching this segment, maybe they were intrigued by the title of this, or they wanted to know more about it, and they didn't know they had an issue, or they don't quite know what their status is. Do you have any suggestions for kind of first steps, second steps to take to assess your own situation?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the first one is to do a really good Google search about state laws. For example, that was the question you asked earlier. In the state of North Carolina, there are four conditions under which, a physician can delegate these clinical tasks to somebody who is not licensed or does not have a clinical background, if you will. Okay, so the first one is to check that. And in the state of North Carolina, you can do that. The second step I would recommend is to look at individual clinical procedures. For example, who can do an EKG? Who can do a phlebotomy? Who can do a pulmonary function test? And for this, usually there are society guidelines. For example, I'm a pulmonologist, and there's a society called American Thoracic Society, and they've spelled out who can do a pulmonary function test. And you will find out that somebody with an associate's background with some specific training can do a pulmonary function test. So that would be the second step. And so similarly for medication administration, state boards can have guidelines on that. And so to know the state medical board policy, to know society document guidelines, and then craft an individual policy, and then take it to health systems and present to them the case where you can balance risk and at the same time achieve value. A health system that does that, and it's publicly available information, is Johns Hopkins. They have on their website how unlicensed clinical coordinators can perform a lot of low-risk clinical skills, ranging from vital signs to EKGs to breathing tests with heavy training and oversight. I think this can allow for like good throughput in performing clinical trials and solve the problem, or at least take a step towards solving the problem of human resource constraints in the industry.
Well, I want to thank you so much for raising awareness of this issue. Again, I suspect a lot of our folks out there weren't aware of this or didn't know too much about it or didn't know how significant the impact was and how to really deal with it. This has been our ACRP TV Spotlight on Navigating State Law Qualifications for Clinical Researchers. We've been speaking with Dr. Murali Ramaswamy, who is the president and CEO of Pulmonics. Doctor, thank you again so much for joining us.
Thank you, Michael. Thanks for having me. Have a great day.